Welcome everyone to this workshop session about solidarity and migration. My name is Staffan, and it's my great pleasure to be joined by Dáire, Diogo, and last but certainly not least, Janina Ochojska, who is a member of the European Parliament representing the European People's Party. We have a few questions that we have prepared, if you are ready, Janina.
Yes, I am ready.
Perfect. So I will start. In recent years, political leaders representing different EU countries have turned quite nationalistic in their rhetoric, but also in policies on migration. What are your thoughts about the EU being a safe harbor for refugees and displaced people fleeing from war?
Yes. So I believe that Europe now is not a safe harbor for people who are forced to leave their country due to the conflicts or persecution. Today, the borders of the Union are being closed. The Schengen zone is becoming more and more theoretical. Border guards and the police are returning to their former posts under the pretext of migratory pressure and a terrorist threat. I don't know what is left of European ideas, of the promises to build a continent that is both strong, united, and fraternal. Where did the dreams of fair and tolerant society go? Utopia has given way to reactionary, nationalist, and racist discourses that bred hatred, fear of another has replaced the kindness. The stranger is demonized and appears to be an absolute evil. The construction of the walls is intended to create the illusion of protecting the population from alleged invaders and hordes of barbarians. The house called Europe is being barricaded, and populism is flourishing everywhere, in Poland, in Hungary, in Catalonia, Scotland, France, Switzerland, England, even in Scandinavia. I see that Europe does not realize that nationalism has never been the solution.
Thank you, Janina. I'm a legal researcher from Ireland, so my question is somewhat legal. It concerns the measures envisaged by the new Pact on Migration and Asylum. I'm wondering if you could identify and explain some of those and consider whether they will be adopted by the Union, and if so, on time.
If this new pact will be adopted by the EU, I don't know, because it depends on the position of the others, members of parliament. But also, I think that there is still a lot of different thoughts between the parliamentarists, because you know when just you read the chapter titles in this document, the fight against smuggling, protecting the Union's borders, improving return and readmission. So these chapters, these titles say all about the way the EU wants to present the migration policy. For example, one of this problem is the conditionality. And I strongly oppose applying conditionality to development aid for partner countries. This conditionality is based on the compliance with returns and readmissions, migration management and border control. So the part of EPP members, they have the same, they see this problem in the same way. And I express this opinion on plenty of occasions during votes or at the plenary session. Also in the intervention during DEVE committee meetings, because I am a member of DEVE committee. And I was also the EPP shadow rapporteur in the EU-Africa strategy. So I succeeded in removing references to migration policy conditionality on EU ODA. And I was able to secure support for the whole document. So it was this was a challenge for the MEPs, because the MEPs were divided on this issue, and there was a serious risk of the report being rejected. And so, you know, this demonstrates how potentially politically controversial the tie is between development and migration policy. And we have to know that migration sometimes are the only way for people to survive. And this, I believe that this tendency will continue with for example, progressive climate change. And border control measures, especially through official development assistance, will not only prevent free movement of persons, which has an impact on development opportunities, but it is also a violation of policy coherence for development and human rights obligations. So, by externalizing the EU's internal migration policies, EU action may contribute to human rights violations, undermine freedom of movement, and disrupt patterns of mobility linked to livelihoods instead of positively contributing to the development goals of poverty reduction. So, you know, these changes in the law proposed by European Commission, I have an impression that they are intended to relieve the countries of Southern Europe, which are under the greatest migratory pressure. And European Commission want to introduce the principle of compulsory solidarity and place emphasis on deportations, enabling those countries that do not want to relocate refugees, like in Poland, for example, and to take on the obligation to return economic migrants to their countries of origin. So for me, this is some kind of contradiction. Obligatory solidarity and deportations, solidarity that comes from an imposed obligation is not a solidarity. So even the president of the European Commission in the talks with our prime minister, Morawiecki, she told that they have this certain rules regarding the need to ensure the most effective policies on border control. And now the European politics towards migration is to control the border and readmission and deportations of refugees.
Thanks very much for a very comprehensive answer, and I really appreciate you sharing your reflections. I just have a minor question just to clarify something that you said earlier. I understand you said that you are against conditionality. Does that include human rights conditionality? Do you object to that sort of conditionality, or only concerning migration management?
No, so in my work, it is this conditionality which is connected with the development aid. It means that if, for example, the countries, I don't know, for example, from the Niger, yes, there is, or Afghanistan now, there is a big discussion about the refugees from Afghanistan. If Afghanistan will agree to readmission or to the return of the refugees, for example, from Austria, because Austria don't want to have too much migrants from Afghanistan. So this is the conditionality that the development aid can be bigger. Yes. So I found that this is not fair. It is I still believe in the ideals of European Union. Yes, at the beginning, really, we thought that this dream about solidarity, about the fraternity, and we thought that together we will be strong and united. And all these ideas now, what they are. So I'm afraid that we will pay a lot. It means we will lose on the confidence of people, and you know, now young people they become more and more nationalist, because I think they don't believe on the ideals. I believe still, yes. So as I told, I was in April in the refugee camp in Greece, and I was in a Ritsona camp. This visit was this visit I planned because I received the information that the Greek government start to construct the walls from the concrete walls in the refugee camps. It is something. Can you imagine how people can live in the area closed by concrete walls 3 meters high? So I spoke with the refugees. They were really very afraid, and I saw that the government started to build this wall. And for the refugees, they told us, they told me, you know, Janina, we think that the local population will think about us as a very dangerous people, because the government closed us in some kind of prison. So what people will think about us? But and for them, even if we think about the security, could you imagine that if there is a fire in this kind of refugee camps close between the concrete walls? But I visited also the Minister of Migration and Asylum in Greece, and Director of IOM in Greece, and they told me that these walls are constructed for the security of the refugees. But the refugees, they didn't feel insecure. Before the camp was closed only with the fence, so they could leave, and they for them, you know, they had the impression that this camp is open, that it is not a prison. And I learned, and it was shocking for me, that this construction of the walls is financed by a European Commission. They gave money to the Greek government to construct these walls. So now I send the questions to European Commission. I received the response without any details. So I sent another letter signed also by the others MIPs. And now we are waiting for the response. But this is a shame, you know, that with the money of European Commission, we closed the refugees in the prison. So what the government of Greece want to make with these refugees? What European Commission want to do with them? They are the people in this camp. They are waiting for the decision, administrative decision about the they stay in Europe, and they are waiting for 2 years, 3 years. So I am not very optimistic if we speak about the future politics of EU towards the migrants, or migrants, or we can say refugees, because we are speaking the problems of migration. It is another problem, yes, because there is also the economic migration, and I found that we in Europe, we need these people, because yes, there is a lot of work. We don't want to do it. So we need the migrants. Like, for example, in Poland, there is a lot of people from Ukraine, about 1.5 million. They are working in different positions, very often in the families. They take care of the old people. They are working also in the constructions. So we need them, but the refugees, they are the people who are seeking the refugee status because of the war, because of the another conflicts, or because of the persecution. So we have an obligation, moral obligation, to help these people and to receive them in Europe. And I want to say and to underline also that I personally suffer a lot because of the politics of Poland towards the refugees. The Polish government don't want to open Poland for the refugees. They didn't want also to participate in the relocation from the refugee camps from Greece or from Italy or from Lebanon. So for me, this is really the shame. And before 2015, Poland was more open, and the changes went to the good solutions. But in 2015, when the extreme right take the power, it was finished. So
my name is Diogo. I'm from Portugal, but at the moment I'm living in Poland. So firstly, I would like also to say thank you, Janina, for sharing so many interesting facts from your visit to the camp in Greece. They are very interesting, but at the same time, very shocking at the same point. Regarding my question about migration, I found the main debate is always about welcome or not welcome migrants. And I do believe, from my personal view, that the borders should be open. However, I also believe that we are avoiding solving the real problem, which is in their home countries, to help the migrants to have and feel safe in their home countries. Of course, find the solution and implement it, it's very challenging because the solutions that work in one country don't work in another one, especially if they don't belong to the same region. So my question is very practical for humble and simple Europeans. What can they do to help migrants to solve the real problem in their home countries?
I have a quite big experience in this issue. In 1992, I created Polish Humanitarian Action, and we started with humanitarian assistance for Bosnia, but now. We have the missions in South Sudan, in Somalia, in Yemen, also in Iraq, and also in Ukraine, in the zone where there is a war. So our aim in each mission or action is to help the local people, to help them to have the better conditions to live. We are specialized in the water sanitation programs. And for example, in South Sudan, we built now more than 800 wells. In fact, the boreholes. People, they have access to the clean water, to the safe water, and they can develop the agriculture, and. I visited, for example, the villages after a year and a half, and I saw, you know, the gardens with the different vegetables. There was a small market. On the market, they were the people who, for example, they had money. They buy the machines to sewing, and people found the different ways to develop the activity, and these people, they don't need to go to Europe because they have the tools And this tool, in this case, this is the water. This is a sanitary development, because we saw them and how to construct the toilets, and they receive also the materials to construct them. So the biggest problem, access to the clean water and to the hygienic to the hygiene, they could develop themselves. We, the European, we first of all, we have to change the attitude towards refugees, to understand why they have to look for a safe place in Europe. And in some cases, it is possible to give them what they need to stay. Because I think that to be a refugee, it is very difficult. And it is not a solution to come to Europe. Of course, I think that we have to receive people who cannot, for example, like with Afghanistan, the Taliban, they have a politics now to find all active people. And in this Ritsona camp, the majority, for example, of refugees, they are people from Afghanistan. And they cannot to return. So we have in Europe, we have to understand these people and to create them the better conditions than the better conditions than in refugee camps, where they, you know, when you are in this kind of camp and you do nothing during 3 years, people they are demobilized. They, for them, it's very difficult to wait, and they don't know how long they will wait. So we have to better managing the migration. And we need more solidarity, responsibility. I know that they are the ideas, but you know, if we will treat them like we would like to be treated, I think that this is the way we can really create for these people the conditions they can survive, or they can stay for a long time. Sometimes they return, but I don't agree that we will create the politics with the walls on our borders. And like, for example, the minister of asylum and migration in Greece, he told me, we have the 0% of the refugees coming to Greece. And he was really very proud of him, because they used to push back the refugees who try to come by the different by the different means. So we need more empathy and to realize the real solidarity. Yes.
Thank you very much, Janina, for your
yes.
answers and for your work on this. I can tell that you, by sharing these insights and your experience, this topic is very important for you and I would just yes. like to thank you for your work. I have a question on the refugee camps in Europe, and if this is something mm-hmm. that is being raised in your work, like in discussions that you come across, speaking about not only making sure that the people that are in the refugee camps now, that they eventually become financially dependent, but also like that the social dimension is also raised. Like my impression or my fear is that we will end up with a very large number of young traumatized men, and we won't, yes. you know, have the tools to, we will need the tools to sort of cope with that as well. And I wonder if this is something that is being raised.
Yes, because, you know, for example, I was really shocked when I learned that children in this camp don't go to school. Why? Because there is no money to pay the transportation. And so there is 650 children in this camp. And the minister of migration and asylum, he told me, you know, the mothers and the children, they don't want the children to go to school, which is not true. He was never in the camp. And so he don't know. And I find this, this is a really shame for us. How we can say that there is no money for transportation? So I presented all these issues, but you know, the European Commission works very slow. They need a lot of time to send you the response, and you can if you want to take a quick way, you have to send the questions in 200 words. So, and if you want to explain in the more words, so it takes 3 months or even more. So there is, I don't have support from my colleagues in our group, because they are not interested in migration. In fact, I am the only one who is interested and who is working on this in different commissions, and I try to have the influence on each document where there is a part about the migration policy. This period of pandemia gave us only the possibility to speak by internet, and for example, the session take 1 hour and a half, and after you have to finish. So it is not easy even to explain you. When I receive 1 minute or 1 minute and a half, I am very happy. I thought that we can work in the commissions in the direct way. So I believe that if everything is going well, we will start in September in the parliament. I believe that I have the power also to convince people to the vision I have about the migration. And I know now that there are some people who think in the same way, but it is the internet is this is a very good tool, but it is not enough. What I can say, I would like to do more, but there are some circumstances which make difficult to have this possibility to speak, because this experience from the refugee camps in Greece, before I was also in Italy, in Sicilia, and this is unhuman to agree that people they live under difficult conditions in the refugee camps, and they are waiting for this administrative decision a very long time. They don't know where they will receive it, because they are not they don't know the law. They don't know that there is nobody to help them, to explain them. And as I told, children don't go to school. There is no medical care. There is no psychologist. They are people. They are people, for example, from Cameroon and from Congo. They are speaking French, and the majority they are the Afghans. They are speaking a lot of them English. So there is nobody who can who will help them to understand each other. So there is not only the problem of the conditions like toilet, like the buildings in which they have their rooms, but this is as you told as a social problem, yes, because they need more support and they need to understand themselves and also to explain them what is the procedure, what they can expect. But I wanted to go also to Spain, but I couldn't go because of the health problems. But I hope that I will do this because it is very important also for me to have this experience perhaps with this experience I will have more possibility to speak with people from European Commission.
Thank you very much, Janka, for your answers, and thank you there, and Diogo for your questions. I've heard, Janka, that you have been to Tese. If you would like to conclude by just or wrap up by just sharing your experiences from Tese.
I say that if we can really live with the ideas we have in our hearts, like there is in Tese, where people, they are authentic. I think that we'll feel better in our countries, in Europe, and I believe that the world can be, in the world, people can live better if they realize the solidarity, the fraternity, if they are open on the difference of the differences in the world and the differences between the people. So we really in the society we run out of these ideas that we can live daily. So yes, for me it is a very important place.
Thank you very much, Janka. And
thank you again also
for your work and for your time with us.
With pleasure, really.
Thanks so much.